Oh, I don't think you're all that great. I mean, it's Sunday. This is when we meet in worship. Oh, good to see you. Okay, I'll do it. Why don't we stand to our feet right where we're at? Come on, let's do it. Let's just stand to our feet. Let's honor God. His presence is here. You know that there's something that happens when we come with expectation, right? If you come with low expectation, many times low standards occur. Isn't that true? But when the people of God come together with one heart, with one mind, and one purpose, God begins to do tremendous things. And how many of you need God to do something tremendous in your life? If you don't, you're lying. Come on now. We really need God. I need him. So let's just begin to cry out to God. Lord, we worship you this morning. And God, we thank you for your presence. Lord, we thank you that you are a God who not only visits his people, but you dwell among us. That, Lord, when we look at the time and the season that we're in now, as we rapidly approach Easter, we see this tomb that's here, God, with a stone that's in front of it. And, Lord, we know that you're not in it, Lord. You've risen from the dead. You're victorious. And, God, you give us that resurrection life every day of the week. And so, Lord, we walk in faith, not only by sight, Lord, but we walk in faith. And we pray that today, Lord, you would meet us in just an awesome way. Lord, we begin to allow our faith to rise now. Not faith in who we are, but faith in who you are, God. Faith that your grace is sufficient. Lord, faith that you are hope beyond hope for us. Faith, Lord, that we have resurrection power abiding in us through your Spirit. So we honor you, God, and we worship you now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Is plentiful, the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Found in a desert place, we'll walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you.
Blessed be the name.
Bless your name, Lord. You are blessed in this place. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you for your promises, Lord. The promises of the Lord are yes and amen. Is casting out fear, and even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near.
I will fear no evil,
and I will fear no evil, for my God is with. If my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? No, no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm.
Never let go of me. Jesus, you never let go. We thank you, Lord Jesus. Let's just sing about who God is. You're holy, you're faithful. You are holy, you are faithful. You are Savior, you are friend. You are all I'll ever need, Lord, you are. You're every question's answer. You are every question's answer. You are every reason why. You are moving, you still, Lord, you are. You are the Lord on high. You are the Lord on high. You are the way, the truth, the life. You are the Word made flesh. You are the bright morning star. You are. Your glory, hallelujah. You are glory, hallelujah. You are hope and peace on earth. You are Alpha and Omega. Comfort, you are refuge, you are love personified, you are kindness and compassion, you are the Lord on high, you are the Lord on high, you are the way, the truth, the life, you are the Word made flesh, you are the bright morning star, you're my God and my King. God and my King, you are the words that I sing, you are the reason I make this your prayer. You are my God and my King, you are the words that I sing, you are the reason I make this. You are my God and my King, you are my God and my King.
Every need. We are so thankful you are the God that breaks addictions in people's lives. You're the God that restores marriages. You're the God that brings jobs and finances. You're the God that heals. You're the God that removes anger, resentment, bitterness. You're the God that frees up those that God cannot forgive somebody else. You are the God that we serve. and you are alive, you are well. And Father, we thank you for that today. That God, we don't stand here and worship some idol. We don't stand here and pretend that you are, that it's something that we can see. God, you are the God that created the universe. You spoke it into existence, and it stays there by your spoken word. And God, we praise you today, because you are the God that we serve. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. You are the first and the last, Lord God. You are a provider, our supplier. God, you meet every need that we have, Lord Jesus. You've never let us go hungry. You've never left us alone, Lord God. You've always been there for us. As long as we pursue you, Father. And so, God, today I just ask that, God, your spirit would be here. That, God, you would show yourself as you have so many times before. That as we get into the Word and as we worship some more, God, that your presence would fall on this congregation. That, God, you would meet needs in the seats as word goes forth. You would pierce the hearts of those that need to get something from you today. That, God, you would show up and wreck us all. God, we're here for you. Not for us, God, but for you. We worship you today. We give our tithes and our offerings, and we say, God, take it and use it, Lord God. Make what we give today a seed offering, Lord God, that goes forth and furthers your kingdom. But God, you will give back to us with what we give to you. God, that's your word. And God, your word is what keeps us here. So Father, we ask today that, God, today would just be a special day. God, we ask that you would bless the offering. God, we ask that you would bless Jan, who's at home today, who's not doing well. Father, we speak healing to his body right now. In the name of Jesus Christ, we rebuke the enemy that has come and has begun to work on his breathing. God, we ask that you would touch him, that you would heal him, that you would just reveal yourself to him right now, Lord God. Father, we also pray for, I believe, Savine's niece, Sarah, Lord God. The Father, you're no respecter of time or place or location. And God, we speak healing to that little girl's body in the name of Jesus Christ. God, that the holes in that heart would be repaired and it would be unexplainable except for a miracle for you. And God, not that we might be glorified, but that you might be glorified, Lord God. So we speak healing to her in the name of Jesus Christ. Satan, you have no power, no authority. We rebuke you. It's done. She will be healed in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, we thank you for it, Lord God. We praise you for it, God. So God, we give the rest of this day to you. And we just ask, Lord God, that you would have your way with each one of us. Thank you, and we praise you for it. In your Son's name, amen.
I sing, you're my God and my King. My God and my King, you are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this offering. You are my God and my King, you are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make,
and you are my God and my King.
You are my God and my King.
You're the Lord on high.
You are the Lord. suffering. You are my God and my King. You are the words that I sing. You are the reason I make this suffering.
Praise you, God. Amen. Amen. You know, would you just go ahead and have a seat this morning, and we're going to continue to worship. I don't want to stop the things God's doing, and he's going to move. But I just feel like even as we were worshiping, I just have a word for you. As we're singing these songs, you remember the first song that we sang. It said, you give and take away, my heart will choose to say, blessed be the name of the Lord. The word, and then the next song, oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. I felt like what God was clearly saying is that devastation is an opportunity for his restoration. That when your life is utterly wrecked and devastated, maybe it's a relationship, maybe it's financially. You know, just the other day, Rochelle and I were driving. We had a friend that we knew, and they used to have a house up in the hills when the fires came. And we hadn't seen them, and so we haven't been by that house in lots of years. We're driving through the neighborhood, and we're seeing, like, these beautiful, I mean, they live in this beautiful large home overlooking all of the city there. And you would see a home, no home, right? And then you would see these brand new, beautiful homes as well. And we're thinking, man, these people are all rebuilding their houses. Then it dawned on us. Was the devastation of that fire that wrecked these houses. And then some, their houses were restored. Others were still in the process of waiting for that restoration. Some had signs on their property saying, thank you to all our neighbors, you know, hope is coming, and these kinds of things. And it was such a vivid picture in the natural of things that happen in the spiritual, right? That our lives go through particular times of devastation. But keep hope alive, keep faith strong, because devastation is an opportunity for God to restore and to redeem and to do things his way. Justin, if you could prepare that video. As you know, we've been a part of contributing to the work that's going on in Haiti, and through Youth with a Mission, through Mission Aviation, and also through Giving Children Hope. And you've been so generous to just give of resources, finances. I think as a church, we raised over $10,000. And the last thing that we did was a concert and dodgeball tournament and skate fest and whatever else happened in the back area there. And just real grassroots, man. Just young people getting together and saying, let's do something. Let's show God's love for Haiti. And it was called Heart for Haiti. And as a result, I think there was about $1,600 that was raised. And it was really cool to see how it was raised. It was just a big jar, and at the front, you go and you put money in it, and then you just play. And it was awesome. You know, the jar just filled up. And we donated that particular money to this effort that's going on through Youth with a Mission. I wanted you to see these pictures. Susie Childers, who's a missionary that we support, who comes often to share with you, and you might remember her, she's the photographer. She went and took a team and documented the devastation there, not as a way to just bring about sad pictures, but as a way to communicate to some of the most influential people that they know, 40 influential, very wealthy people, to be a part of a 20, 30, 40 year process of rebuilding the nation of Haiti. And so I just thought, God's doing something here. Would you just look at the pictures? And as you look at them and see this quick video, would you let your heart be an intercession for the devastation of those that you know around you, but also for this nation, that God would use this as an opportunity to bring restoration. So let's see it, Justin. Thank you. Isn't that awesome? Strength and unity, that's the national slogan for Haiti now, that as they band together. And I share with you those pictures as a reminder. I don't know about you, but when I watched that video, the thing that struck me, two things that struck me the most was the joy and the hope in the faces of the children. That is the next generation. That is the people who will be leading the nation. The other thing that struck me was the worshipers, the people. You saw that blue tarp church, right? That's classic all over the developing world, that you have a group of people that are suited up to their Sunday best and just extending their hands in worship, worshiping the same God that we worship. And I think that we just need to be reminded in the midst of the things that we're experiencing that we have brothers and sisters. Isn't that sad what's happening in that part of the world, but those are our brothers and sisters worshiping the same God. So I just felt it was right and good that I share that with you, and we're going to continue to pray and believe that in the midst of the devastation in Haiti that God will be the hope and the rebuilder, just as he's doing that in our lives. Amen? Amen. Ryan, would you come up? Ryan Valle is back, and he's looking good, man. You know, you send a guy away for 6 months, he comes back wearing a skirt. I don't know. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just messing with you, dude. Can you grab that microphone? For those of you that don't know Ryan, Ryan was away in the island nation of Fiji and also was in Samoa for just a minute. And God has just been doing a neat work in Ryan, a time of training and teaching and then a release into that part of the world to just spread the gospel. And we got to hear from Ryan a little bit yesterday, but I just want to give you a chance to say hello to everybody. And also I want to ask you to pray for Haiti this morning as we take that time to wrap up. But go ahead, man, say hi to everybody.
Bula. That's hi, Fijian. And can I say hamidat?
That's hi in
South Korean or Korean. Yeah, it's good to see everybody again. Oh, wow. I'm just want to give you a little bit of encouragement that, you know, I was really scared to come back here because I've grown so much, and just see you guys grow so much, and just how, you know, just in worship, just the short bit I've been here, and then also in the men's breakfast yesterday has really touched my heart. And I just love that God just works everywhere. So, should I just pray for Haiti, or should I just give
Tell
a
shout?
Okay, that's okay. Well, I did a DTS, a discipleship training school in Kona, Hawaii, and it's a 6-month school, and best season of my life that I've lived so far, and I know there's greater to come, but God just directed me for the ordinary, or not the ordinary that the world perceives, but I'm now living a life that is filled with his passion and just this wild adventure that he wants to take us all through.
Amen.
And I've just been learning more of God's character, and I know that I only know just a handful of what loads more that he wants to give us. So I got a lot in. I'll just break it down. First 3 months is a lot of lectures about characteristics of God or different other topics like spiritual warfare. During that time, I would say that the biggest thing that happened in my life is I got healed a lot from my past, addictions, and just getting myself to a point where I can just be in open communication with the God, you know, just to be, you know, not to like go in like, okay, God, I need you now. No, just be like, hey, I'm here, you know, just being an open, constant communication, you know, like just him and the Father, you know. So I just got healed so much from everything that was still holding me back from living the life that I could. And, you know, you learn a lot more, also just how to do ministry and how to, you know, share the knowledge that God has given you, and that's outreach. And we prayed into it, and I really felt that my heart was supposed to go to Fiji. So I went to Fiji, and they're just such beautiful people. The reflection of God in their culture is just so great, that you could just be walking down the street, and if you just say hi to somebody, they could just pull you into your house, and the next thing you know, you're gone 2 hours, and you've been talking to these wonderful people forever, just sharing about your life and God, and just so encouraging. And I feel like I could go talk on for hours, but you know, I'm here, you can talk to me, just pull me aside whenever you want, and just let you know that thank you for investing in me, giving me the funds to go out and outreach. It helped me so much become the man that I need to be. God walking through me and saying that this is who I need to be, and to walk out in that, and not to be shy in that, but saying this is who you are, and just to walk in the authority that He gives us. That it's not something that we deserve, but it's something that He gives freely, and just to take it because that's what He wants us to walk in. So yeah. We're gonna switch over and we'll just stop.
Hey, before you pray, let me say this. I encourage all the men, I'll encourage all of you, take Ryan out to lunch and meet with him and hear the stories. I'm not just trying to get free meals for him, I did tell him that. But it's the things that God does, it's really hard to share it in front of a bunch of people, but it's great to be able to sit and chat about the things God did. And so just want to encourage you all just to do that. And Ryan, you say yes when they ask you. All right. Let's pray for Haiti, Ryan.
My Father, we come before you now, and knowing that you've done everything in your power to just reconstruct this nation of Haiti, Lord, that you knew that they needed to be loved so much by the world, knowing that this was just a pivotal point in their history, in their nation, and in their people, Lord, that you love them so much that you had to just wipe away all the evils of this world and have a clean slate, Lord. And I just pray, Lord, as we love you, let's focus on what's on your heart, where there's a burning passion in your heart, Lord Father. And let this be a time to know that the world would see that this is the time that you showed up big, Lord. And that we would be obedient as the body of Christ, working together in unity, Lord. As Haiti, the nation of Haiti, has totally got the new message that you've been wanting to tell us. Something, not something new, but something that you've been telling us since the beginning. To be unified in the body of Christ, Lord. Like we could, I'm so encouraged about how this church is in part and open with Order of Christian Organization. I just pray that as the body of Christ, we continue unifying and build up this nation, Lord, that we would have long-term missionaries or long-term people just to have a heart for that you've placed in their heart. And Lord, we just pray that you would just give instructions to us, and the wisdom of the kingdom of God would just come down, Lord, and just fall down. The wisdom would fall down. The love would fall down, Lord Father. And Lord Father, we give this all to you, knowing that you hold everything in place. And let's just walk in obedience to your name, Lord, and to your love. And that not only that the nation of Haiti will go deeper, but as we are the body of Christ, the brothers and sisters helping them out, Lord, that we can go deeper as well with them. That all of us will continue to grow into your name, Lord Father. That we just continue to grow deeper into your desires and the relationship that you've always desired, Lord. I just pray that the relationships would be long-lasting, not something fickle, but just something that is just cemented in your name, Lord. Yeah, thank you, Lord, for all the wonderful things that you've done and all the wonderful glory that you've already done, and knowing that everything has already been victorious because you already have the victory, Lord Father. And let's just walk obedience to the victory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Ryan. Welcome back. Would you turn in your Bibles with me to the book of 2 Chronicles? And as we're turning there, just a couple of things. I did hear back from the youth that are up in the mountains. I know you've been praying for them. They've been having an awesome time. I think they're planning on being back between 1 and 2 this afternoon, for all you parents that are wondering when you're getting your kids back. They're having a great time. And so thank you all for praying for them as they've had this mountain retreat. Also, tonight, don't forget, is a night of worship, and we're just going to gather as a family of God. Yeah, it's going to be good, Kelly. Thanks for the claps. 6 o'clock, and we have childcare available for kindergarten, preschool through kindergarten, or infant through kindergarten, and it's just a time for us to be together as the church and to seek God and to use our spiritual gifts and just meet with Him. So plan on being here. It'll be a great time. We really believe it's going to be a time where God is going to converge a lot of things that have been happening in different ministries, with men's ministry, women's ministry, youth, everybody, that we just all be together as the family of God. So that's that about that. And one last thing, if you want to get the DVD of Linda Britt teaching an incredible teaching on the battlefield of the mind, we've got a DVD set available, but you need to sign up for it. So if you could go to the info booth or see Lisa Harris, you'll get that. It's really good, actually. John Bush did an amazing job filming and editing it, so it's really, really good, and you'll enjoy it. So that's that. And if you would get there to 2 Chronicles, maybe you are already there. I want to take a little bit of time, and I want to read this passage to you, and then I want to give us time to soak in some of the things that God's going to speak to us through his word. And we're going to come back to a place of worship in just a little bit, and in that time as well, we want to share some things that God did last Sunday, just right here at this altar. How many of you felt just a special touch from God? If you could just raise your hand. Yeah, you just see around. And some people felt not only just this warm, fuzzy, special feeling, but also literal healing, physical healing, and other people just things happening in their mind and God doing good things there and doing a restoring work. That's what God's all about. He really is. And in this season in time, it's so important that we're able to just declare what God has done. This is God doing it. You know, I got to tell you, there's nothing special that we do other than living a life of obedience and surrender and speaking his word. That's our role. That's just what we do as servants of God, no matter what, no matter what season we're in, whether we feel him or not feeling, whether he gives or he takes away. We just continue doing what believers do, persevering, showing up, loving one another, walking in unity, speaking the truth in love. But I gotta tell you, when God decides to just show up, we just want him to stick around, you know? And when he does that, and the scripture tells us that we can either embrace it and walk with the Lord and allow that flow to come in us and flow out of us into places like Haiti or into places like Orange Old Town or wherever you work, or we can quench and stop that work through our own efforts and through our own pride. And so that's kind of where we're at right now. In my thinking is, gosh, you know, I don't want to take an ounce of glory because I know that outside of just doing my best to serve Jesus and our staff the same, we didn't do anything different. We just showed up and we worship God. And God graces us with his gifts. That's what the word says, that he graces us with his gifts. How do you grace someone with something? Here you go. Yeah, it's a sound effect. And you have the choice to either go, oh, wow, I like that, thank you. Or you can step back and look at it, or you can resent it and go, why are you giving me a gift for? I don't want that. That gift wasn't for now. That was some old gift. I don't want that gift. He's gracing us right now. And our response is either to go, yeah, and then to open it up and allow that gift of God's Spirit to take work and root in us, and then just thank him like crazy for what he's doing. And that's the story. I want to go to the Old Testament, though, just so you see. And I began to show you this a little bit last week. And I want to, as I prayed about the service today, I felt it was important that we go back over it. And it's a story that comes from Jehoshaphat in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. And you get to see the working of God's Spirit in the Old Testament. You know, the Holy Spirit just didn't come to being in the second chapter of Acts. But the Spirit of God has been hovering over this earth. The Spirit of God is part of the unity and the Trinity, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is God. How do you explain that theologically? It's very difficult. Three in one, you know, and volumes of books are written about this idea. But you can't separate Jesus from God and the Holy Spirit. They're in perfect unity with one another, each having a different expression. And you see the expression of the Holy Spirit take place here as we read this story. I'm going to read a bunch of scripture because I believe in it. The Bible says don't neglect the public reading of scripture. That at least you know, if I'm just like blah, 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 blah up here, at least you know you're going to get some scripture today. And scripture is transformational. That just the reading of it has an effect in your life. So this is for you. After this is chapter 20, verse 1. And let me give you the background. You're gonna see it as I read it, but Jehoshaphat's the king, and there's three nations about to make war on him, and they're getting close. They're moving in pretty fast, and he has an opportunity to respond in several different ways, but from everything we read, he responds the right way, and God really does an amazing work. It says, after this, the Moabites, the Ammonites, and the Meunites came to make war on Jehoshaphat, and some men came and told Jehoshaphat, a vast army is coming against you from Edom on the other side of the sea and is already at Hazazon Tamar, that is in Gedi. Alarmed, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord and proclaimed a fast for all of Judah. And the people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town of Judah to seek him. And then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said, our Lord, God of our fathers, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. Oh, our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of the land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? Verse 8 says, and they lived in it and had built a sanctuary for your name, saying, if calamity comes upon us, whether the sword or judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before that temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress. And you hear us and you'll save us. But now here are men from Ammon and Moab and Seir, whose territory would not allow Israel to invade. They came from Egypt. And so they turned away from them and did not destroy them. And see how they are repaying us by coming to drive us out of the possession you gave us as an inheritance. Oh, our God, will you not judge them? For we have no power and to face this vast army that is attacking us. Are you relating to anything so far as we're reading this stuff? We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Man, I could just stop and end right there. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you. Verse 13 says, all the men of Judah with their wives and their children and their little ones stood there before the Lord, and the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jehazel, son of Zechariah, the son of Benaniah, the son of Jael, and the son of Mattaniah, a Levite, a descendant of Asaph. And he stood up in the assembly and he said, listen, King Jehoshaphat and all you who live in Jerusalem, this is what the Lord says to you. Do not be afraid or do not be discouraged because of this vast army, for the battle is not yours, it's God's. Tomorrow, march down against them, and they will be climbing up by the pass of Ziz. That's just a very cool pass, the pass of Ziz, by the way. And you will find them at the end of the gorge of the desert of Jerul. Verse 17 says, you will not have to fight this battle. Take up your position, stand firm, and see the deliverance that the Lord will give you. O Judah and Jerusalem, do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out and face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you. And Jehoshaphat bowed with his face to the ground, and all the people of Judah and Jerusalem stood, and they praised the Lord, the God of Israel, with a very loud voice. Early in the morning, they left for the desert of Tekoa, and they set out, and Jehoshaphat stood and said, listen to me, Judah and people of Jerusalem. Have faith in the Lord your God. You will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful. And after consulting the people, Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing and praise him and praise the Lord for the splendor of his holiness. And as they went out and ahead of the army, saying, give thanks to the Lord for his love endures. And now in 22, it says this. As they began to sing, the Lord set ambushes against the men of Ammon and Moab and Mount Seir who were invading Judah, and they were defeated. And the men of Moab and Ammon rose up against the men from Mount Seir to destroy and annihilate them. And after they finished slaughtering the men from Seir, they helped destroy one another. Listen, that is some morbid stuff for sure. But do you see what's happening in this Old Testament story? That there's some principles that take place. That God literally fights a battle on behalf of his people. And if you're fighting your own battle, maybe you can just raise your hand and tell me how it's working for you. Are you winning? Probably not. And if you think that you are, you might be deceived. Because see, that's what the enemy does. He deceives us with this false sense of security that we're doing really good and we're doing all the work and whatever else. But we are desperately dependent upon God. We have to rely upon God for everything. And God never lets us down. He never lets us down. And I want to just go through a couple of these principles in this particular passage. And I want to give us some time to reflect and to think, how do we respond to the mounting armies that come against us? How do we respond to tax season? How do we respond to what's going on in our particular job situation or our lack of a job situation? You know, do we run in fear? Are we able to embrace the possibilities with God? Remember what we said and what we looked at in these pictures from Haiti is that devastation is an opportunity for God's restoration. And it's so true. But don't you like understanding this about Jehoshaphat? This guy is a king. He's got a group of people around him. Everybody would tell him whatever he wants to hear just to make him feel good about himself. That's how those things work, right? A king has ultimate power. But this particular king recognizes the fact that he was alarmed. He was alarmed. And I want to tell you something right now, that in whatever your situation is, if you're alarmed, you're all right, okay? You don't have to wear some kind of false strength. You know, it is okay to be alarmed. Do you hear what I'm saying? That there are alarming things that are happening in your world. But see, the great thing about God is what we learn from Jehoshaphat is we don't have to stay there. We acknowledge that before the Lord. We say, we're alarmed, right? But then this, I love this scripture. I remember one of our men's retreat speakers years ago repeated this over and over again. He said, Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord. Let me ask you this question. When you're alarmed, when you're panicked, when you're worried, what is your resolution? What do you resolve to do? Just think about it for a second. You know, I have to look at my own life honestly and say sometimes I resolve to panic, you know? I had this really bad habit I'm getting better at. I've shared it with you before, but when I lose something, I like my wallet or my keys, it's like the end of the world, you know? It's like, what are we gonna do? I'm tearing stuff apart and asking my wife like 47 times, have you seen my wallet? Have you seen my wallet? I'm like, have you seen my wallet? Have you seen my wallet? And she said, you've asked me several times. And she's peacefully, patiently looking and she's holding it like this, you know, and I'm scurrying around the house and finally I come and get it, right? And we, knowing how ridiculous that is, I made this saying. I said, it's always good to overreact. It's not. But sometimes when we're alarmed and it's human nature, that we resolve to panic, we resolve to worry. And guess what? It doesn't work. It doesn't do anything but get my heart racing. It doesn't do anything but get us so frustrated and so distracted that we can't see right from left, up from down. All we can see is just confusion. Panic is a natural reaction to being alarmed, but it's not what we should resolve to do. Sometimes if you're anything like me, I can resolve to worry. Worry is more than just saying, oh no, what's gonna happen? Worry, as from what I understand from scripture, brings about anxiety. And worry is playing over scenario after scenario after scenario of what the possibilities could be. And you know what the truth is? Most of the time, all those possibilities, in fact, like 99% of the time, they don't happen. The worst doesn't happen. Can I just tell you that? That's my experience in life. Is it yours? You know, my daughter, Kate, for some reason, has this thing about tornadoes. I don't know where it came from. And she'll say just randomly, do you think there'll be a tornado today? And I said, no, I'm pretty sure there won't be. But somehow in her mind that there's this something she saw or, you know, they poisoned her in kindergarten. I don't know where it happened, but somehow she just asks out of the blue. And that just gives insight to me that something's going on in her head, thinking, I wonder if there's going to be a tornado today and I better be on my guard and grounded in case there is. Oh, hey. It could happen, but chances are it won't. But see, if we resolve to panic, then we're stuck in our mind going after scenario after scenario. Another resolve that we can resolve to is avoidance and procrastination. And I just gotta be honest, human nature, we're probably good at all three of these things. You know, I'm just gonna avoid it, it's gonna go away, just not do anything about it. You know, you might have a stack of bills or whatever else. You think if I just leave it as a stack, it'll probably just go away, you know? If I don't just pay, it'd probably just leave, you know? It's in God's hands, you know, it's not my problem, you know. Come on, guys, right? It's okay to be alarmed. But when we're alarmed, what do we resolve to do? Jehoshaphat resolved to inquire of the Lord, and this is how he did it. See, because it's great to hear a sermon about doing the thing, but how do we do it? How do we inquire of the Lord? First thing that he does is as the king, and you got to grasp the significance of this, he is a king. He's a king, and he humbles himself before the Lord. That's a big deal. It's a big deal. And you know what? For us, it's a big deal to humble ourselves. Some of you are successful. Some of you, many of you are successful in, you know, in the world's eyes, in monetary things, in work, and whatever else. And sometimes we can have that success as this throne kind of thing, you know, and for a king it would be that way. A king would be so esteemed and so highly regarded that he's got to have everything under control. Parents are good at that, right? We got everything under control. We got to take care of it. Let's not worry about it. But you see, this amazing thing happens, that he resolves to inquire of the Lord. He humbles himself. And not only does he humble himself, but he calls all those who he has influence over to humble themselves as well. It's one thing to seek the Lord by yourself, and it's good to do it. But I got to tell you that it is exponentially better to seek God with somebody else. Can I say that again so that maybe it will go, yeah, whoa. It's good to seek God by yourself, and it is good and right to fast and pray, and that's what he does. But it is exponentially, meaning it is multiplied over and over and over again when you seek him with somebody else and when you seek him in the context of a corporate community. That's what the church is about. The church is about a group of people with one heart and one mind seeking God together. And you're going to see something that happens in the Old Testament. Church didn't even exist yet. But something of church happened in this Old Testament story when people got together and they knelt before the Lord and they sought the Lord. What they began to do is pray. You heard Jehoshaphat talking to the Lord. And what Jehoshaphat did was he reminded himself who God was. Don and Anita have done such a great job at this phrase. I love it. It's called rehearsing the character of God. Rehearsing it. Where over and over again, we remind ourselves who God is. And did you catch what he said when he had humbled himself and he had prayed and he had sought the Lord? In verse 5, just real quick, look at it with me. It says, power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. Can I say that again? Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. That wasn't just a, man, I sure hope power and might are in your hand, God, because if it's not, we're toast. Get the picture of what's happening. Three armies unified together, ready, like approaching quickly. A king who can't defend himself. Alarmed, he inquires, he seeks of the Lord. He makes a declaration. God, you're so powerful, and everything is in your hands. I want to encourage you in your situation, whatever it might be, that you would take that. If you take anything away, hopefully you're going to take more than that, but if you could just take that away, if you could take and just sort of lay that over whatever's heavy in your life, lay that over what's impossible in your life, because certainly Jehoshaphat's situation was literally impossible. And if you could lay over that impossible situation, power and might are in your hands. God has all power, all authority, and nothing is too difficult for him, or no one can withstand you. God can do anything, anytime, any place, any way, anyhow. He's God. He's God. You know the only thing he's limited by? Us. He's limited by us. Our unwillingness to surrender to him, our unwillingness to seek him, our unwillingness to say, okay, you can take this. Because he doesn't work when we're working at the same time. What he does is he goes, okay, have you ever seen like the hamster and the thing? He's like, all right, go for it. I can just imagine him with the angels just going, hey, check him out. Watch. He's like 10 years into this. Anytime now, he's going to lay out. Ah, there he goes. All right, let's go to work. Let's go to work, boys. It's kind of the principle of Scripture. Here's another thing that happens as they seek the Lord together in community. Remember, I said it's good to seek him alone, but sometimes we can have this false sense of security. It's just me and God, just me and God. I'm praying, I'm fasting, I'm doing the work, I'm reading Scripture like 90 hours a week, you know, I'm whatever. But if you're not doing it with other people, if you're not letting other people into your situation, you're very limited. You're very limited. Yes, God can speak to you. Yes, he can sovereignly do what he did to the Apostle Paul. But right after, you remember the Apostle Paul situation just sort of laid him out, right? Blind. And now he brings him right into fellowship with somebody else who begins to teach him the ways of God. You have to have somebody with you. You have to. It's how it works. And so in this Old Testament story, look with me at verse 13 of chapter 20. Jehazel, this guy, who is he anyways? Do you know anything about this guy? Do people name their kids after him? He gets one shot, man. He one time in Scripture, obscure guy. We don't really know much about him other than the fact that he's a Levite. He's just one of us. That's what he is. He's just one of us. It wasn't, you know, the priest of the day. It wasn't a prophet who had a whole book in the Bible. It was Jehazel, one of us. But the Spirit of God comes on him. And it says, the Spirit of the Lord came on Jehazel, son of Zechariah, son of Benaniah, and so forth. And it goes on to who he is. He's a Levite. He's one who would minister before the Lord, and a descendant of Asaph, maybe even one who would do it in music. And he stood in the assembly and he said, listen, King Jehoshaphat and all who live in Judah and Jerusalem. There was an opportunity for him to speak. And there's an opportunity for you to speak. There's an opportunity for you to share the things that God is doing in your heart, whether it be publicly, or I think even sometimes more significantly, when it happens privately, when it happens in the midst of ministry, when somebody comes up and taps you on the shoulder and says, man, I think God's saying such and such. I think that the Lord is telling me this about your situation. I've said this many times, but if you would just let me know, how many of you have been literally changed as a result of somebody who just gave you a word from God? It just gave you such hope. It brought you through a season. You see, we need to be doing that more often. We need to seek God on behalf of somebody else and just be open to what the Lord might be saying to someone else through us. And that's exactly what happens. He tells the strategy and he goes forth with it in verse 16. Here's the message he says Let's do it 17. It says, you will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions. Listen to all these action words, okay? Although that God's going to fight the battle for him, you still got to show up. We said that last week. God fights for you, but you still got to show up. You still got to march out. Listen to all the commands. Take up your position, right? Stand firm and see the deliverance of God. That taking up your position means you gotta get from point A to point B. You have to move out in faith and walk towards that wave. You know, that a huge wave will overwhelm you. But if you want to get past a huge wave, the best opportunity you have is to swim like crazy, straight for it, right? And it's that idea of taking your position. What are you afraid of? What are the things that are difficult in your life? Begin to walk towards those things with faith in God. And then stand firm, right? Stand firm in the truth and the promises of God. And then watch and see what God does. That's where faith comes in. It's like this. You're moving towards it. The wave's coming. You're standing there and you're going, all right, any minute now. Any minute now. I'm watching. God, you're going to do this thing. And faith rises. And if your experience with God is anything like mine, it's right at that moment where you're about to get totally toasted by whatever, that God lifts you up and picks you and delivers you. And I don't know why he does that. Maybe he just wants us so dependent and so desperate on him. But it's at that moment where you just think you're gonna lose it. It's at that moment where you just think you're gonna be overwhelmed and overtaking. That is the moment of your deliverance. Do you believe me? I'm not sure if you really do. It's so true. And here, that this point is so important for this very reason, is because it's at that point where we're this close to deliverance that we oftentimes bail out. It's at that point where we go, oh, God's never going to do it. It's where our declaration, which was once, oh, God, nothing is too difficult to you or for you, and no one can withstand your power, where our declaration becomes, oh, man, I knew it. I mean, we saw this little kid at the grocery store the other day, and he was all upset because his dad was coming down on him and told him he couldn't do something. And he's like, oh, why, God? Why do you do this to me? He's like 10. Oh, God, why? Oy vey. Yeah, he was just so, oh. And we were still looking at each other, was laughing. He was so dramatic, you know. But isn't that the kind of thing that we do? His dad just told him to quit messing around, you know. His dad told him just to calm down. He was just like, da, 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 da. His dad was like, chill out. And kid just needed to stand still, stand firm, and watch the deliverance of dad was about to come. No, I'm just kidding. But listen, we're so like that. We are so like that. And it's right at our moment that God's going to move that oftentimes we bail out. The response of Jehoshaphat is really tremendous, because after he hears this message in verse 18, you see that he fell down and he worshiped before God. That is huge. Remember who he is again. He's the king. He's got secret service. He's got people around him. He's the king. Falls down on his face and worships before God. He's humble. If we want to see God move in our life, our greatest enemy is pride. We've got to humble ourselves. Pride masks itself in so many different ways. But essentially, pride is that I can do it better than you. I got this one, right? It just... amazing to me how many times I make that mistake and I just think, well, I got this one, God, I'm good, you know. And maybe you've been there too. I can deal with this one, Lord. I know you're busy dealing with situations in Haiti and all over the world. I got this one. No, you don't, and I don't. We don't have anything. You know what scripture teaches us? We're nothing without him. The sooner that we can learn that, the better that we are. The sooner that we can learn that we are putty in the hands of a potter who can somehow make clay, that can somehow make something beautiful, if we'll just cooperate, man, the better that we are. It's not us working for him, it's him working in us and through us. All these verbs that are in the New Testament, they're these passive verbs that really indicate him doing the work and us just cooperating with the work. And man, we wear ourselves out like that hamster in the wheel. Trying to help him out, when what he wants most of us is surrender, trust, and obedience. That's what he wants. So simple to lay it out in a sentence, but not so easy to apply. But what do we resolve to do? Do we inquire of the Lord? Jehoshaphat models it. He falls down and he worships the living God. He goes on and some other things occur. But I want to kind of bring things to a close here. And there's all kinds of notes here. You know, you kind of think, which ones do you say? Which ones do you not? Maybe one question that I could ask you is this, as I had asked myself the same one, is how do I respond to a word from the Lord? How do I respond to like this right now? And this isn't, hopefully you see that. This is not me just talking. And my prayer is always where it is me just talking, that it would kind of fall off. But what's of God, those aha moments, the things that click for you, the things that I see, oh, someone's writing that down. That means that God is speaking something to you. How do you respond to it? Does it end up in a notebook somewhere that you have a list of things that he said? Or do we take the time, like we're going to do this morning, to sit in his presence and to allow it to stir around in us and allow us to get humble enough and to get quiet enough for the Lord to show us what to do now? If you're anything like me, again, I get real excited when God talks, right? Oh, whoa. And I'm in school right now, and so I'm reading all kinds. Whoa. There's like whoa everywhere. But you got to do something with that, right? It isn't just that you go, whoa. It's that you go, whoa, now what do I do? And so oftentimes we go, whoa, my friend really needs to learn this, you know? Whoa, church has got to hear this one. Whoa, you know, maybe you could say, whoa, my husband really has to get a grasp with this one. Yeah, that's human nature. But until we, like Jehoshaphat, the king, humble ourselves, kneel before the Lord and go, whoa, now what? Now what, God, what does that mean to me? Here's a last point, okay? I'm going to pass get you past a bunch of stuff. The heart of Jehazel's message, again, an obscure guy. And by the way, how do you respond to the word of the Lord when it comes from an obscure guy? How do you respond to the Lord when it comes from somebody that you don't really particularly think should be given words from the Lord that are just wacky? And they're out there. And we're some of them, you know? Who does God use? Donkeys. Messed up people. It's all in the book, you know? That's one of the reasons we know the Bible is real. There's a certain criteria there. It's called the criterion of embarrassment. It is. It's a literal theological term. The criterion of embarrassment is one of the ways that you know these stories are real. You don't put in there things like someone going to the bathroom or falling down or losing their clothes as they run away when you're trying to make a great story up. Those are stories you write. You don't leave the embarrassing data in there. You know, you take that stuff out. Our Bible leaves a bunch of embarrassing stuff in there so that all of us can sit back and go, oh yeah, stuff's real. So maybe that's a little aha moment for some of us. How do we look at those that are kind of obscure? Maybe they're not the big name person. Maybe they're not the one that should look like someone who delivers a word from the Lord. You know? How do we handle that? All right. Here's the heart of Jehazel's message. And here's a little tip for all of us when we're studying scripture. A real easy thing to do is pay attention to what's repeated. If something's repeated, underline it, circle it, highlight it, do whatever you do in your Bible or however you want to handle it. But repeated things in the Bible are there for a reason, and it's not brain science to figure out why. If you repeat something over and over again, what's your intention? That the reader or the listener would get what you're trying to say. You know, it's like my kids, dad, 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 dad. Okay, got it. Get the message. Something is repeated here, and it's repeated, it says, do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. It's at the beginning of the word and at the end of the word. You can look at it on your own. Read what Jehazel said, underline it. Your version might be dismayed. It might say dismayed. It means the same thing. Do not be afraid, do not be discouraged. Why? Why? Why should they not be afraid? Why should they not be discouraged? Why should you not be afraid? Why should you not be discouraged? You know what? It's because you don't have to fight this battle unless you choose to. You don't have to fight this battle. You got to march out, you got to show up, and you got to stand firm, and you got to wait, watch, and just see. Hebrews, just an obscure little verse. I was reading in my own quiet time in Hebrews chapter 2, verse 16. The author of Hebrews is addressing this issue where the church at that time was buying into some false teaching about the power of angels and exalting angels a little higher than God. And it was all kinds of wacky stuff. Wacky things happen in churches, right? We've already said that. Weird teachings come in and so forth. Puts us on edge. God is always faithful to bring a correction to those things. He's always faithful if we'll seek him and obey him. Use his word as a standard. He'll iron it out. And so that's what the author was doing, is ironing out some of this stuff. And he was in that process of doing that, because the context was this misunderstanding about who angels are. He gives us this passage of scripture. He says, angels are like this, you're like this. It's like some comparisons going on. And read this with me really quick. It's in verse 16, if you're not already there. He says, for surely it is not angels that he helps, but Abraham's descendants. Surely it's not angels that he helps. Angels don't need help. He looks at us a little different here. Surely it's not angels that he helps, but it's Abraham's descendants. You can go, I can take you through some scripture that'll show you that you get in on that Abraham descendants thing. You know, you can go to Galatians, you'll see it. You go different places, you're in. I'm not just saying trust me. I mean, it's in the book. I just don't have time to go through the whole thing. You're part of it. You're part of those promises. You can look at angels like, whoa, angels. And they, man, if we saw one, I think we would, I was going to say we would need a diaper. I don't know why I was going to say that, but that's what I was thinking. But if we saw an angel, it would be like that, right? They're just, whoa. They're powerful. They're something to behold. But God doesn't help them. He helps you. How does God look at you? We might be really impressed with angels, but God's really impressed with you. And some new insight comes as you look into that word of what it means that he helps. It's a Greek word, and it's called epilambanomai, right? And I know that you guys know that. It sounds like an Italian word, really, but it's Greek. And that word is more than just he helps, but the word is that he takes hold. He takes hold of you. That's why you don't have to be afraid. That's why you don't have to be discouraged. It's used at different times in scripture in different ways specifically, but let me give you some ideas of what it says. To take hold of, to grasp, to catch, to assist, to be concerned for. This is what it's saying, that's how God is towards you. That's why you don't have to be worried. But listen to this. You remember when Peter was walking on the water, you know the story, right? And as he walked on the water and he saw the storm and things happen and whatever, and then he begins to sink, guess what Jesus did for him? He epilambanied him, you know? He picked him up. That's what that Greek word is. He grasped him. Do you remember a time when there was a blind man and Jesus did that really cool miracle where he spit in the ground and made mud and so forth? Where it says that he used that same word where he grasped the hand of that blind person and he led them out. He led that blind person out of the city and into that dirt spot, and he did that miracle. I thought that was really cool. Another time, though, that it also uses that same word of grasping or taking hold was when Simon of Cyrene grasped and took hold of the cross for Jesus. You see, that's the picture of what he does for us. I want to take a minute and I'm going to invite Ben and the worship team to come back up. We still have a little bit of time. And in this little bit of time, I want to give you the chance to not just go, that's an okay message, or that was a good message, or whatever. I mean, I want us to somehow, I can only say this because I know that I do that, you know, that we would break past that hearing of a word, but that we would just go, okay, we just sought you together, we began in worship, and now we want to end in worship. We want to begin to ask you, God, what are you saying to me? What are you saying to me? How am I going to respond? I have some questions that we can ponder as the worship team leads us in some songs of worship. One of the questions is this: will you resolve to inquire of the Lord? Will you resolve to inquire of him? Remember, we can resolve to do a bunch of things. We can resolve to panic. We can resolve to procrastination. It's no doubt we can admit it. We're all alarmed. Come on. But we can resolve to panic, procrastination, fear, anxiety, all that stuff. Or we can resolve to inquire of him, ask him, God, what do you want to do here? Will we listen even if the messenger is obscure? You know? Will we humble ourselves along with those of us around? You know, so it's not just, will I humble myself when it's just me? Man, it's easy when it's just you in your prayer closet to get all crazy for God and to lay out before him and kneel and weep and do all that stuff that we do. And that isn't necessarily the sign of really seeking him. That often is what occurs. But my point is this, it's not much of a sacrifice. It is somewhat of a sacrifice, but it's much more when we're together corporately, realizing that I'm seeking God not just on my behalf, but I'm actually seeking God on behalf of others. And there's a growth that occurs there. Will I march out and take action when I hear the word of God? And finally, will I find rest in the fact that his overwhelming, overriding message is, I've got this. That's his message. That's why we can find rest, is because he's there to grasp. He's there to help. Do not be discouraged. Do not be dismayed. Does any of this make sense? I sure hope so. Can we just, if you want to sit, sit. If you want to rise to your feet, rise to your feet. If you want to come to the altar, whatever it is that would help you, postures of worship help you to connect with God. That's why we do it. Raising of hands helps you to surrender. It's an action, right? Kneeling to your knees, if you can do it, helps you to humble yourself before God. Laying out before the Lord just says, God, I'm dirt and I lower myself below you. Would you come and speak? All of it speaks to this part about just being desperate, a desperation for God to just speak to you. So let's take a moment now and we're going to continue to worship.
When the music fades and all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to I'll bring you more than a song. For
and these few moments, I believe, are going to be extremely significant. So I want to invite you just to hang on with us. But we'd be wrong not to give God glory for what he did last Sunday. And Robin, would you just come and share? The Lord really touched Robin in a specific way. And I wanted to just continue to worship and just listen to what the Lord did. And she came in with something of a hurt hip, and God really touched her.
Well, first of all, I didn't want to come to church last Sunday, okay? I had a really bad attitude last week. Nancy, I had a heating pad and been gay, and I was like, really, Lord? Really? You're going to do this to me? And I was reminding the Lord of everything that I was trying to do for him. And Sunday, I was really, really chewed through, and I didn't want to come. I didn't tell Danny that, but Lillian needs to come to church. So when I came in, I seen Sharon, and I was limping. I hurt so bad. I went to the emergency room, but I don't have insurance. They're going to send me to UCI. I have to pay my taxes. Oh, I reminded the Lord all morning, Sunday morning. I'm laying at Nancy's house, and I'm like, really, God? I mean, I really had a bad attitude. And so your word was just like, okay, so I come through the door. The Lord says to me, get up and walk. And I said, I'm not picking up my mat. I'm walk. I'll drag it to church, and I'll take Lillian because she really needs to go. So when Danny gave the altar thing, I said, Lillian, would you like me to pray over you? She was thinking of trying to stand up, and Sharon came up, and she grabbed me, and she said, the Lord said to pray over your hip. And so we came up here, and my attitude was so bad that I was just like, Lord, I'm so sorry. You've been so good to me, and you've been so faithful to me, and I forgot about my hip. I had this attitude that I wasn't like to listen to God. I didn't go and worship in his presence. And all of a sudden, after Sharon was praying, my hip got warm, and a peace came over me. And we laughed, and I jogged up the hill at Lillian's. And she lives up Acacia in Old Fullerton. It's a big hill. I went swimming, and the Lord was reminding me of my attitude and how he's just so funny. He probably just looked at me and just shook his head. But I showed up. I didn't want to come. I was tired, I was hurting, I'm worried, but I came. And you know what? He healed my hip, and he changed my attitude. And so it was the hip was like the extra blessing. Because my attitude, when our attitudes, you know, and you're in front of Christians, and you're like, praise God. You know, but inside you're like, really, God? But I was like that all week, and I tried to hide it from everybody. But when I was up here with Sharon, and she's praying for me, she's praying for my hip, and God just convicted me so bad, because I don't want to be like that. And so it was just like, I didn't even share that with Danny, but your word just had me over there sniffling like a baby.
You know, let's stand to our feet, all of us together. Really, Lord, we give you complete and total glory for anything that happens that's good in our life. It isn't the effort of one person or any other thing. Then you love us, and you have this unfailing love. God, I know we can all relate to Robin. It is a miracle that you would touch our physical body, but it is a miracle that you would change our attitude. We know ourselves. We know our frame. We know the weakness that we have. And so, Lord, we invite that process of transformation and change. Lord, change us, renew us, strengthen us, and heal and restore. God, we know you did other things on Sunday. You've done things today. And we say this, that all glory and honor is yours. All of it, God. Let all of it be unto you. Lord, may we never grieve you. May we never quench you. Lord, may we keep our eyes fixed on you and walk in obedience. Lord, may we walk in humility. May we resolve to inquire of the Lord. Lord, may we do it together in community. Lord, help us not to isolate, but Lord, help us to embrace the people, even if they're obscure, even if they're different, the people of God, Lord, that we would walk together as one. I'd like to sing one last worship song as we close, and then we'll just close in a word of prayer. So Ben, if you just lead us.
Sing, I'm giving you my heart.
Giving you my heart, and all that is within. Lay it all down for the sake of you, my King. Giving you my heart.
surrender all day long, all week long. Don't let go. He's not letting go of you. He's grasping you. He's helping you. He's for you. And I want to invite you, come back tonight. Come back and surrender whatever the things are that you need God to touch, whether it's a physical ailment that keeps you, whether it's an attitude, whatever it is. Come back so that we can do what we read about this morning, that we can seek God together. And come also with an expectancy that not only does God want to touch you, but God wants to use you. Come with an expectancy that you just might be that obscure person, that Jehazel type of person, that God just might want to use you. It would be just like him to do it. And so God bless you. And let's stay surrendered. We'll see you later tonight. Have a great, great week.